Candor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Trauma and the Body, a Sensorimotor Approach to Psychotherapy by Pat Ogden, Kekuni Minton, and Clare Payne. Forewords by Daniel J. Siegel, M.D., and Bessel A. Vanderkolk, M.D. Narrated by Paul Brion. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Note to listeners: Standards of clinical practice and protocol change over time, and no technique or recommendation is guaranteed to be safe or effective in all circumstances. This volume is intended as a general information resource for professionals practicing in the field of psychotherapy and mental health. It is not a substitute for appropriate training, peer review, and/or clinical supervision. Neither the publisher nor the authors can guarantee the complete accuracy, efficacy, or appropriateness of any particular recommendation in every respect. Series Editor's Foreword, Daniel J. Siegel. An interpersonal neurobiology perspective draws on a broad range of disciplines to create an integrated picture of human experience and the development of well-being. Using parallel findings from various fields of science, clinical practice, and the expressive and contemplative arts, this consilient approach to understand being human attempts to weave a wide vision of our subjective experience. By bringing together often disparate ways of knowing, the aim of this endeavor is to expand our view of the mind and promote well-being in individuals, couples, families, communities, and our larger society. Trauma has a huge impact on all aspects of our human civilization and individual lives. Yet, the reality of trauma is often overlooked in societal approaches to public policy, education, and the resources offered for the promotion of mental health. How can the pain of trauma be so often missed? When we write books or formulate approaches to an issue, we are often filled with concepts and words that distance us from the experiential reality of the topic at hand. Often, we think in words, creating abstract ideas framed by linguistic packets of information, such as these you are listening to right now. Such word-based theoretical frameworks are important in pulling us out of the immediacy of moment-to-moment experience, allowing us to gain a perspective on the larger picture than what direct sensation by itself allows. The benefit of this experiential distance is to give us a clearer vision of the whole by creating a wide perspective of a broad entity. But abstract ideas symbolized by words can also make it difficult for us to sense the lived details of our human experience. Such experiential knowing is often created best through direct sensation. Without the balance of the non-linguistic world of images, feelings, and sensations, the seduction of words and ideas can keep us from direct experience in our daily lives and professional work. On a societal level, such an imbalance can keep us in a state of denial. In a psychotherapeutic setting, focusing primarily on word-based thinking and narratives can keep therapy at a surface level, and trauma may remain unresolved. An overemphasis on logical, linguistic, linear, and literal thinking may tilt the balance of our minds away from the important sensorimotor, holistic, autobiographical, stress-reducing, image-based self-regulatory functions of our nonverbal neural modes of processing. Linking these two very different but important ways of knowing is the essence of creating balance in our lives and in our understanding of complex human experiences such as trauma. The central idea of interpersonal neurobiology is that integration is at the heart of well-being. Integration is the linking of differentiated elements into a functional whole. With an integrated system, our lives become flexible, adaptive, coherent, energized, and stable. Without this integration, the flow of our minds moves toward rigidity or chaos. In this way, trauma can be seen to fundamentally impair integration with an individual, dyad, family, or community. Post-traumatic states are filled with experiences of rigidity or chaos that continue the devastation of trauma long past the initial overwhelming events. By integrating many domains of our experience within a receptive form of awareness, we develop a more connected and harmonious flow in our lives. Such linkages include implicit with explicit memory, left with right hemisphere modes of processing, and mindful awareness with bodily sensation. Our minds have an innate movement toward integration and healing that may often be blocked after trauma. Releasing this drive toward well-being is a central goal of psychotherapy that enables the creation of integrated states that establish adaptive self-regulation. The therapist can utilize the view that neural integration, a coherent mind, and empathic relationships form three sides of a triangle of mental health that can be seen as the focus of healing in the process of psychotherapy. Within an interpersonal neurobiology view of therapy, as we sift the mind, we attempt to integrate the sensations, images, feelings, and thoughts that comprise the flow of energy and information that defines our mental lives. Sensations include the nonverbal textures created by the body that involve the state of the muscles in our limbs and face, our internal organs, impulses to act, and actual movements. Sifting the mind with curiosity, openness, acceptance, and love, the coal that warms the heart of change, enables us to integrate these many elements of our mind in new ways that permit healing to emerge. As we focus on these many domains of the mind, the empathic communication within psychotherapy enables new states of coherence to develop as neural integration, the physiological linkage of the widely distributed neural patterns in the brain and body proper, evolves, and new forms of healthy, adaptive self-regulation are established. In Trauma in the Body, Pat Ogden and her colleagues offer us deep experiential insights that can awaken our minds to the wisdom of the body. By turning toward the body with mindful awareness of here and now sensory experience, the pathways to integration are opened and healing becomes possible. This receptive awareness involves an accepting, loving, non-judgmental attention that may be the essence of how the mind can move from chaos and rigidity in non-integrated states to the coherent functioning that emerges with integration. Mindful awareness of the body enables the individual to move directly into previously warded off states of activation, which left the body out of the experience of mental life following acute or chronic traumatization. With beautifully articulated applications of neurobiology, extensively referencing state-of-the-art scientific literature, the authors create an exquisite theoretical framework in the first half of the book. This framework sets the stage for the whole forest view that emphasizes why clinicians should intellectually and linguistically understand the central importance of the non-intellectual, non-linguistic, neural, and interpersonal processing of the individual. The mind, often unaware of these sensory and motoric states of the body, can finally achieve the integration that adaptations to trauma had blocked for so long. The second half of the book offers a phase-oriented description of the how-to behind the practical aspects of these important therapeutic interactions. A sensorimotor approach to psychotherapy is more than just using the body as another frame of reference for rationalizing good psychotherapy. Rather, turning to the sensations, impulses, and movements of the body enables the therapist to open the crucial world of the nonverbal for direct processing within mindful awareness that is useful for a range of psychotherapeutic approaches. Focusing on the body for the achievement of mental well-being is an approach spanning thousands of years of practice in the contemplative traditions. Somehow, in modern times, we have forgotten the hard-earned wisdom of these ancient traditions. Modern neural science clearly points to the central role of the body in the creation of emotion and meaning. Though some interpretations of neuroscience think of the single skulled brain as the source of all that is mental, this restricted view misses the scientifically established reality that most brains live in a body and are part of a social world of other brains. The brain is hardwired to connect to other minds, to create images of others' intentional states, affective expressions, and bodily states of arousal that, through our mirror neuron system's fundamental capacity to create emotional resonance, serve as the gateway of empathy. In this way, we see that the mind is both relational and embodied. The authors of this wise text pay careful attention to the scientific reality of the embodied and relational mind in understanding the impact of trauma and in delineating a pathway toward healing. The interactions between therapist and client/patient, seen through the light of this attachment-informed, somatic, and sensory-focused work, enables clinicians of all persuasions to understand practical approaches to psychological growth and development in a new and useful light. While this perspective is based on extensive clinical practice, its theoretical framework is consistent with science. Bringing a sensory-motor focus to therapy pushes the envelope of our understanding of the interface between subjective experience and objective research findings into a wonderfully new realm. The authors have taken on the important challenge of putting words to a world without words. It is my pleasure to introduce you to their important contribution to understanding the relational and embodied mind in the Norton series on interpersonal neurobiology. Let it bathe all the dimensions of your mind, and let us know your experience. Foreword, Bessel A. van der Kolk, M.D. The dramatic advances in neuroscience over the past decade have led to important new insights into how mind and brain process traumatic experiences. The work of neuroscientists such as Antonio Damasio, Joseph Ledoux, Jacques Panksepp, Steve Porges, Rodolfo Yinas, and Richie Davidson has shown that living creatures more or less automatically respond to incoming sensory information with relatively stable action patterns, predictable behaviors that can be elicited over and over again when they are presented with similar input. The function of the mind, that extraordinary human capacity to observe, know, and predict, is to inhibit, organize, and modulate those automatic responses, thereby helping us manage and preserve our relationships with our fellow human beings, on whom we so desperately depend for meaning, company, affirmation, protection, and connection. However, the mind, although able to organize our feelings and impulses, does not seem to be particularly well equipped to entirely abolish unacceptable emotions, thoughts, and impulses. In fact, it seems to be geared more toward creating a rationale for troublesome behavior, for example, it's for your own good or to create a better world, than toward eliminating it. As a consequence, people seem to be condemned to accommodating their irrational longings and unacceptable feelings of fear, anger, helplessness, lust, and despair without ever being able to completely master them. Fundamentally, life is about making our way in the world, and how we do that depends on the hardwiring of our brains. This hardwiring is derived from the evolutionary legacy that we more or less share with all living creatures, combined with the imprints of our own personal early experiences. The basic blueprint of our map of the world and the way we move through it consists of connections between the arousal system of the brain, the reptilian brain, and the interpretive system in the mammalian brain, the limbic system. These connections organize how all animals, including humans, organize their responses to sensory stimuli, and these responses, first and foremost, concern movement. Neuroscience research has come a long way in helping to clarify why the same stimulus that pleases some people irritates others. Emotional responses occur not by conscious choice, but by disposition. Limbic brain structures, such as the amygdala, tag incoming sensory stimuli to determine their emotional significance. The interpretation of these subcortical brain structures is based largely on prior experience, which determines our disposition to approach or avoid whatever we encounter. Moreover, it is becoming more and more apparent that response refers to an action we are impelled to take, that is, how we are physically inclined to move after receiving any particular stimulus. Neuroscience has confirmed earlier observations by scientists such as Darwin and William James that physical bodily feelings form the substrate of the emotional states that shape the quality of our decision-making efforts and the solutions we create to deal with particular dilemmas. These physical feelings, in turn, propel the human organism to take certain actions. As Roger Sperry, who won the Nobel Prize for Medicine in 1981, said, "The brain is an organ of and for movement. The brain is the organ that moves the muscles. It does many other things, but all of them are secondary to making our bodies move." Sperry claimed that even perception is secondary to movement. Insofar as an organism perceives a given object, it is prepared to respond to it. The presence or absence of adaptive reaction potentialities, ready to discharge into motor patterns, makes the difference between perceiving and not perceiving. The neuroscientist Rodolfo Yinas summarized the relationship between action and the brain as follows. In order to make its way in the world, any actively moving creature must be able to predict what is to come and find its way where it needs to go. Prediction occurs by the formation of sensorimotor image based on hearing, vision, or touch, which contextualizes the external world and compares it with the existing internal map. The comparison of internal and external worlds results in appropriate action. A movement is made. People experience the combinations of sensations and an urge for physical activation as an emotion. Both Charles Darwin and Ivan Pavlov clearly understood that the goal of emotions is to bring about physical movement, to help the organism get out of harm's way in the case of negative emotions, and to move it in the direction of the source of the stimulus in the case of positive ones. Darwin, in particular, pointed out that human beings are not any different from animals in this regard. Emotions activate the organism to respond in prescribed ways, such as defending oneself, preparing to fight, turning one's back on someone, or approaching someone for greater intimacy and care. In short, emotions serve as guides for action. Nina Bull, Jacques Panksepp, Antonio Damasio, and others have demonstrated that each particular emotional state automatically activates distinct action tendencies, a programmed sequence of actions. When people process incoming perceptions, they interpret the new information by comparing it with prior experience. On the basis of this comparison, the organism predicts the outcome of various possible actions and organizes a physical response to the incoming stimulus. As Damasio said, physical actions are creating the context for mental actions. Bottom-up processes are affecting upper-level processes. This is the feeling of what is happening. Damasio further explained, "It makes good housekeeping sense that the brain structures governing attention and structures processing emotion should be in the vicinity of one another. Moreover, it also makes good housekeeping sense that all of these structures should be in the vicinity of those which regulate and signal body state. This is because the consequences of having emotion and attention are entirely related to the fundamental business of managing life within the organism, while, on the other hand, it is not possible to manage life and maintain homeostatic balance without data on the current state of the organism's body proper. What makes people unique in the animal kingdom is their flexibility, their capacity to make choices about how they respond to their environment. This flexibility is the result of the property of the human neocortex to integrate a large variety of different pieces of information, to attach meaning to both the incoming input and the physical urges, tendencies, that these evoke, and to apply logical thought to calculate the long-term effect of any particular action. This allows people to continually discover new ways of dealing with incoming information and to modify their responses on the basis of the lessons they have learned in a much more complex way than the conditions we see in dogs and other animals. However, this capacity to respond in a flexible manner emerges only slowly over the course of human development and is easily disrupted. Small children have little control of their crying and clinging when they feel abandoned, nor do they have much control over expressing their excitement when they are delighted. Even adults are prone to engage in automatic behaviors when they are stirred by intense emotions. They are likely to execute whatever action tendency is associated with any particular emotion. Confrontation and inhibition with anger, physical paralysis with fear, physical collapse in response to helplessness, an inexorable impulse to move towards sources of joy, such as running toward people we love, followed by an urge to embrace them, and so on. Since at least 1889, it has been noted that traumatized individuals are prone to respond to reminders of the past by automatically engaging in physical actions that must have been appropriate at the time of the trauma, but that are now irrelevant. As Genet noted, traumatized patients are continuing the action, or rather the attempted action, which began when the thing happened, and they exhaust themselves in these everlasting recommencements. The current discoveries in the neurosciences about the automatic activation of hormonal secretions, emotional states, and physical reactions in response to sensory input have once again confronted psychology with a reality that was first emphatically articulated by Freud, that most human actions and motivations are based on processes that are not under conscious control. The implications of these discoveries are particularly relevant for understanding and treating traumatized individuals. Realizing that they are prone to activate automatic trauma-related hormonal secretions and physical action patterns clarifies why they would tend to respond to certain triggers with irrational, that is, subcortically initiated, responses that are irrelevant and even harmful in the context of present demands. They may blow up in response to minor provocations, freeze when frustrated, and become helpless in the face of trivial challenges. Without a historical context to understand the somatic and motoric carryover from the past, their emotions appear out of place and their actions bizarre. These symptoms of an uncompleted past tend to become a source of shame and embarrassment to those who experience them. One of the most robust findings of the neuroimaging studies of traumatized people is that, under stress, the higher brain areas involved in executive functioning, planning for the future, anticipating the consequences of one's actions, and inhibiting inappropriate responses become less active. Just like small children lose the veneer of socialization and throw temper tantrums when they are frustrated, traumatized adults are prone to revert to primitive self-protective responses when they perceive certain stimuli as a threat. Once sensory triggers of past trauma activate the emotional brain to engage in its habitual protective devices, the resulting changes in sympathetic and parasympathetic activation interfere with effective executive function. The higher brain functions have less control over behavior, causing a behavioral regression. Without well-functioning rational brains, individuals are prone to revert to rigid, fixed action patterns. The automatic behavioral flight, fight, or freeze responses that are our evolutionary heritage of dealing with threat and our individual implicit memories of how our own bodies once attempted to cope with the threat of becoming overwhelmed. The legacy of trauma is that these somatic, that is, endocrine and motoric patterns can be triggered by the slightest provocations, reactivating the physical response of the organism to past terror, abandonment, and helplessness, sometimes in exquisite detail. Psychology and psychiatry, as disciplines, have paid scant attention to the behavioral, that is, muscular organic responses that are triggered by trauma reminders, and instead have narrowly focused on either the neurochemistry or the emotional states associated with reminders. They thereby may have lost sight of the forest for the trees. Both neurochemistry and emotions are activated in order to bring about certain bodily postures and physical movements that are meant to protect, engage, and defend. The dramatic advances in pharmacotherapy have helped enormously to control some of the neurochemical abnormalities caused by trauma, but they obviously are not capable of correcting the imbalance. The fact that triggers reinstate some of the hormonal and motoric responses to the original trauma raises some important issues. The DSM-IV definition of post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, emphasizes physiological hyperarousal in response to traumatic reminders. However, trauma is not simply a physiological response. The essence of trauma is utter helplessness combined with abandonment by potentially protective caregivers. Probably the best animal model for this phenomenon is that of the inescapable shock, in which creatures are tortured without being unable to do anything to affect the outcome of events. This causes them to collapse and stop trying to fight or escape. For human beings, the best predictor of something becoming traumatic seems to be a situation in which they no longer can imagine a way out, when fighting or fleeing no longer is an option, and they feel overpowered and helpless. As Darwin already pointed out, the emotions of fear, disgust, anger, or depression are signals to communicate to others to back off or protect. When a person is traumatized, these emotions do not produce the results for which they were intended. The predator does not back off, desist, or protect, and whatever action the traumatized person takes fails to restore a sense of safety. After one or more confrontations with the futility of their emotions and automatic action patterns to restore safety and control, many traumatized children and adults seem to lose the capacity to utilize their emotions as guides for effective action. Their emotions may get activated, but they don't recognize what they are feeling. This is called an inability to verbally identify the meaning of physical sensations and muscle activation, alexithymia. This inability to recognize what is going on inside, to correctly identify sensations, emotions, and physical states, causes individuals to be out of touch with their needs and incapable of taking care of them, and often extends to having difficulty appreciating the emotional states and needs of those around them. Unable to gauge and modulate their own internal states, they habitually collapse in the face of threat or lash out in response to minor irritations. the hallmark of daily life becomes futility. When contemporary trauma studies rediscovered the profound disruptions in the subjective experience of physical sensations and the automatic activation of fixed action patterns in traumatized children and adults, the French psychiatrist Pierre Genet had done extensive research on this issue a century ago, but we did not recognize his contribution till later. The mainstream therapeutic community found itself at a loss as how to address the deficits in those areas. One point was clear. The rational executive brain, the mind, the part that needs to be functional in order to engage in the process of psychotherapy, has very limited capacity to squelch sensations, control emotional arousal, and change fixed action patterns. The problem that Damasio articulated had to be solved. We use our minds not to discover facts, but to hide them. One of the things the screen hides most effectively is the body, our own body, by which I mean the ins and outs of it, its interiors. Like a veil thrown over the skin to secure its modesty, the screen partially removes from the mind the inner states of the body, those that constitute the flow of life as it wanders in the journey of each day. The elusiveness of emotions and feelings is probably an indication of how we cover to the presentation of our bodies, how much mental imagery masks the reality of the body. Given that understanding and insight are the main staples of both cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT, and psychodynamic psychotherapy, the principal therapies currently taught in professional schools, the discoveries in neuroscience research have been difficult to integrate with contemporary therapeutic practice. Neither CBT nor psychodynamic therapeutic techniques pay much attention to the experience and interpretation of physical sensations and pre-programmed physical action patterns. Given that Joseph Ledoux had shown that, at least in rats, emotional memories are forever, and that the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, the center for insight, understanding, and planning for the future, has virtually no connecting pathways to affect the workings of the emotional brain, the best verbal therapies can offer is to help people inhibit the automatic physical actions that their emotions provoke. In short, verbal therapies can help people with anger management, that is, quieting themselves down before blowing off the handle, such as in counting to 10 and taking deep breaths. The realization that insight and understanding are not enough to keep traumatized people from regularly feeling and acting as if they were traumatized all over again forced clinicians to explore techniques that offer the possibility of reprogramming these automatic physical responses. It was only natural that such techniques would have to involve methods that address people's awareness of their internal sensations and their physical action patterns. Of course, many different cultures have healing traditions that activate and utilize physical movement and breath, such as yoga, qigong, tai chi, and other Asian and African traditions. However, in the West, approaches that involve working with sensation and movement have been fragmented and have remained outside the mainstream of medical and psychological teaching. Nevertheless, working with sensation and movement has been extensively explored in such techniques as focusing, sensory awareness, Feldenkrais, Rolfing, the F.M. Alexander technique, body-mind centering, somatic experiencing, Pesso-Boyden psychotherapy, Rubenfeld synergy, authentic movement, the Hekomi method, Middendorf breathwork, and many others. Although each of these techniques involves very sophisticated approaches, the nature and effects of these practices are not easily articulated, and as Don Hamlin Johnson noted, their meanings are not easily captured in the dominant intellectual categories. The most noteworthy integration of bodywork and mainstream science occurred when Nicolaas ten Bergen discussed the Alexander technique in his 1973 Nobel Prize acceptance speech. During the past few decades, several body-oriented practitioners specifically have addressed the somatosensory impact of trauma. To my mind, the three outstanding teachers in this area, those who have had the most profound influence on myself and many of the clinicians I work with, have been Pat Ogden, the author of this book, Peter Levine, and Al Pesso. After decades of training in Rolfing, Hekomi, and other body-oriented techniques, Pat Ogden integrated the psychological and neurobiological effects of trauma with bodywork and has founded a new school of therapy that incorporates work with sensorimotor processes firmly anchored in attachment theory, neuroscience, and traditional psychotherapeutic practice. Sensorimotor psychotherapy is sensitive to the fact that most trauma occurs in the context of interpersonal relationships. This reality means that trauma involves boundary violations, loss of autonomous action, and loss of self-regulation. When people lack sources of support and sustenance, such as is common with abused children, women trapped in domestic violence, and incarcerated men, they are likely to learn to respond to abuse and threats with mechanistic compliance or resigned submission. Particularly, if the brutalization has been repetitive and unrelenting, they are vulnerable to ongoing physiological dysregulation, that is, states of extreme hypo and hyperarousal, accompanied by physical immobilization. Often, these responses become habitual. As a result, many victims develop chronic problems initiating effective independent action, even in situations where rationally they would be expected to be able to stand up for themselves and take care of things. Many traumatized individuals learn to dissociate and compartmentalize. They may seem competent and focused most of the time, but they may suddenly collapse into primitive and inflexible states of helplessness and immobilization when they are confronted with situations or sensations that remind them of the past. Some may remain aware of what they are feeling, what is going on around them, about potential escape routes, and physical impulses to protect themselves, whereas others space out and lose contact with both their internal sensations and what is going on in their environment. Many clinicians, when assessing for dissociative problems, focus on emotions and behaviors. However, sensorimotor psychotherapy specifically deals with dissociative symptoms that involve body sensations, movement disorders, dysregulated physiological arousal, lack of body sensations, and re-experiencing the trauma in somatosensory fragments. Describing traumatic experiences in conventional verbal therapy is likely to activate implicit memories in the form of trauma-related physical sensations, physiological dysregulation, involuntary movements, and the accompanying emotions of helplessness, fear, shame, and rage, without providing the resources to process these nonverbal remnants of the past. When this sequence occurs, trauma victims are likely to feel that it is still not safe to deal with the trauma. Instead, they will tend to seek a supportive relationship in the present. The therapist thereby becomes a refuge from a life marked by ineffectiveness and futility. Sensorimotor psychotherapy directly addresses the fact that the traumatic past continues to influence how people perceive themselves and their surroundings, and how they position themselves in relationship to the world around them. Rather than focusing on how people make meaning of their experience, their narrative of the past, the focus is on clients' physical self-experience and self-awareness. Body-oriented therapies are predicated on the notion that past experience is embodied in present physiological states and action tendencies. The trauma is reenacted in breath, gestures, sensory perceptions, movement, emotion, and thought. The role of the therapist is to facilitate self-awareness and self-regulation, rather than to witness and interpret the trauma. Therapy involves working with sensations and action tendencies in order to discover new ways of orienting and moving through the world. Working with traumatized individuals entails the overcoming of several major obstacles. One is that, although human contact and attunement are cardinal elements of physiological self-regulation, interpersonal trauma often results in a fear of intimacy. For many people, the anticipation of closeness and attunement automatically evokes implicit memories of hurt, betrayal, and abandonment. As a result, feeling seen and understood, which helps most people feel calm and in control, may precipitate a reliving of the trauma in individuals who have been victimized in intimate relationships. Therefore, before trust can be established, it is important to help clients create a physical sense of control by working on the establishment of physical boundaries, exploring ways of regulating physiological arousal using breath and body movement, and focusing on regaining a physical sense of being able to defend and protect themselves. It may be useful to explore previous experiences of safety and competence and to activate memories of what it feels like to experience pleasure, enjoyment, focus, power, and effectiveness. Working with trauma is as much about the person remembering how he or she survived as it is about addressing what is broken. As Pat Ogden emphasizes in this book, discovering the abandoned, empowering active defenses that were ineffective at the time of the trauma. Another problem is that, neurobiologically speaking, the only part of the conscious brain that is capable of influencing emotional states, which are localized in the limbic system, is the medial prefrontal cortex, the part that is involved in introspection, that is, attending to the internal state of the organism. Various neuroimaging studies reviewed in this book have shown decreased activation of the medial prefrontal cortex in individuals with PTSD. This means that traumatized individuals, as a rule, have serious problems attending to their inner sensations and perceptions. When asked to focus on internal sensations, they tend to feel overwhelmed or deny having any. When they finally do pay attention to their inner world, they usually encounter a minefield of trauma-related perceptions, sensations, and emotions. They often feel disgusted with themselves and usually have a very negative body image. As far as they are concerned, the less attention they pay to their bodies, the better. Yet, one cannot learn to take care of oneself without being in touch with the demands and requirements of one's physical self. Hence, Pat Ogden proposes that therapy is about learning to become a careful observer of the ebb and flow of internal experience, mindfully noticing whatever thoughts, feelings, body sensations, and impulses emerge. Traumatized individuals, first and foremost, need to learn that it is safe to have feelings and sensations. In this process, it is critical for clients to become aware that bodily experience never remains static. Unlike at the moment of a trauma, when everything seems to freeze in time, physical sensations and emotions are in a constant state of flux. In order to deal with the past, traumatized people need to activate their medial prefrontal cortex, their capacity for introspection. Therapy needs to help them develop a deep curiosity about their internal experience. This curiosity is essential in learning to identify their physical sensations and to translate their emotions and sensations into communicable language. Communicable, most of all, to themselves. Once people realize that their internal sensations continuously shift and change, that they have considerable control over their physiological states, and that remembering the past does not inevitably result in overwhelming emotions, they can start to explore ways to actively influence the organization of their internal landscape. As patients learn to tolerate being aware of their physical experience, they discover physical impulses and options that they had abandoned for the sake of survival during the trauma. These impulses and options manifest themselves in subtle body movements such as twisting, turning, or backing away. Amplifying these physical impulses and experimenting with ways to modify them ultimately bring the incomplete trauma-related action tendencies to completion. Traumatized people often lose the effective use of fight-or-flight defenses and respond to perceived threat with immobilization. Sensorimotor psychotherapy helps them reorient to the present by learning to attend to non-traumatic stimuli. This focus opens them up to learning from new experiences, rather than reliving the past over and over again, without modification by subsequent information. Once they learn to reorient themselves to the present, individuals can experiment with responding to perceived threats by rediscovering their lost capacities to actively defend and protect themselves. Sensorimotor psychotherapy is based on the premise that, in order to overcome the tendency to be trapped in the past, the traumatized person needs to, 1. Become aware of old automatic maladaptive action tendencies. 2. Learn to inhibit the initial impulses. 3. Experiment with various alternatives to bring to completion the incomplete frozen actions that prove to be futile at the moment of the trauma. And 4. Practice ways to execute alternative effective actions. Pat Ogden's book is the first work to integrate our knowledge of body-oriented therapy, neuroscience, and attachment theory into a composite treatment method. Hopefully, after this wonderful integration, therapy for traumatized individuals will take a giant leap forward and never be the same. Introduction. The body, for a host of reasons, has been left out of the talking cure. Psychotherapists who have been trained in models of psychodynamic, psychoanalytic, or cognitive therapeutic approaches are skilled at listening to the language and affect of the client. They track clients' associations, fantasies, and signs of psychic conflict, distress, and defenses. They register the various narrative threads clients bring, bearing in mind how and where the childhood story repeats itself in the present. They are skilled in creating the therapeutic alliance, working within a therapeutic frame, and recognizing transference and countertransference nuances and enactments. They monitor physical symptoms using psychopharmacological interventions when indicated, and they invariably take note of the physical presentation of their clients, such as the mannerisms, subtle changes in weight or choice of clothing, the slumped posture of a depressed client, or agitated movements of an anxious client. Yet, although most therapists are trained to notice the appearance and even the movements of the client's body, working directly with a client's embodied experience is largely viewed as peripheral to traditional therapeutic formulation, treatment plan, and interventions. Sensorimotor psychotherapy builds on traditional psychotherapeutic understanding, but approaches the body as central in the therapeutic field of awareness, and includes observational skills, theories, and interventions not usually practiced in psychodynamic psychotherapy. Theoretical principles and treatment approaches from both the mental health and body psychotherapy traditions are integrated in this approach. Sensorimotor psychotherapy draws heavily from the Hakomi method, a form of body-oriented psychotherapy pioneered by Ron Kurtz, as a foundation for therapeutic skills, and incorporates theory and technique from psychodynamic psychotherapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, neuroscience, and theories of attachment and dissociation. The premise of this book is that traditionally trained therapists can increase the depth and efficacy of their clinical work by adding body-oriented interventions to their repertoire. We use the term sensorimotor psychotherapy generically to indicate an approach that incorporates somatic interventions that are used by most body psychotherapists. However, sensorimotor psychotherapy is also a school that has developed body psychology theory to guide the use of somatic interventions. So the term is also used to refer to the synthesis unique to this school. The school teaches working with body sensation and movement, but generally excludes the use of touch. The judicious use of touch in psychotherapy may occasionally be helpful in specific situations, but is also potentially problematic and is not a necessary component of this method. We know that trauma has profound effects on the body and nervous system, and that many symptoms of traumatized individuals are somatically driven. Clients suffering from unresolved trauma nearly always report unregulated body experience. An uncontrollable cascade of strong emotions and physical sensations triggered by reminders of the trauma replays endlessly in the body. This chronic physiological arousal often is at the root of the recurring post-traumatic symptoms for which the client seeks therapy. The capacity to assimilate the traumatic experience within a life narrative is not yet available for these individuals, both because traumatic memories are not encoded in autobiographical memory, and because the recurring trauma-related arousal continues to create a somatic sense of threat, a speechless terror. Traditional therapeutic models are based primarily on the idea that change occurs through a process of narrative expression and formulation in a top-down manner. For example, one principle of psychodynamic treatment models, stated simplistically, is that successfully facilitating effective connection to painful past experience and addressing the accompanying cognitive distortions within the context of a therapeutic relationship will bring about a positive change in sense of self, and thereby a relief of suffering and improvement in well-being. The working premise is that a significant change in the client's cognitions and emotions will affect change in the physical or embodied experience of the client's sense of self. The prime target for therapeutic intervention is therefore the client's language. That is, the narrative is the entry point into the therapeutic process. The client's verbal representation, beliefs, and affects are engaged, explored, and reworked through the therapeutic relationship. Improving ego functioning, clarifying meaning, formulating a narrative, and working with emotional experience are fundamentally helpful interventions that accomplish real gains for the client. To these already useful cognitive and dynamic practices and techniques, we propose the addition of bottom-up interventions that address the repetitive, unbidden physical sensations, movement inhibitions, and somatosensory intrusions characteristic of unresolved trauma. Traumatized clients are haunted by the return of trauma-related sensorimotor reactions in such forms as intrusive images, sounds, smells, body sensations, physical pain, constriction, numbing, and the inability to modulate arousal. By including body sensation and movement as a primary avenue in processing trauma, sensorimotor psychotherapy teaches the therapist to use body-centered interventions to reduce these symptoms and promote changes in the cognitions, emotions, belief systems, and capacity for relatedness in the client. The practice of sensorimotor psychotherapy blends theory and technique from cognitive and dynamic therapy with straightforward somatic awareness and movement interventions, such as helping clients become aware of their bodies, track bodily sensations, and implement physical actions that promote empowerment and competency. Clients are taught to observe the relationship between their physical organization and beliefs and emotions, noticing, for example, how a self-representation uttered in a here-and-now therapy moment, such as, "I'm a bad person," affects physical sensation, posture, autonomic arousal, and movement. They also learn how their physical sensations, postures, and movements affect their emotional state and influence the words and content they describe in therapy. Such interventions actively incorporate the body into therapy, providing a more unified mind-body approach to the treatment of trauma. Within the context of a relationally attuned therapy, clinicians can help clients become curious and interested in how the body's responses to past trauma continue in the context of present-day life, and in how to change these responses to enable more adaptive functioning. Most psychotherapeutic approaches do not provide a methodology that directly addresses trauma-related bodily responses and chronically activated somatic symptoms. Instead, they focus primarily on cognitive, behavioral, psychodynamic, and psychopharmacological interventions that, despite having been validated through research, are only somewhat successful in treating the trauma-related disorders seen in clinical practice. Therapists of all disciplines are often puzzled and frustrated by the limitations of existing treatment modalities to resolve the symptoms of trauma in their clients. This book responds to the need for a somatic approach to trauma therapy that addresses the scarcity of literature on this subject and is accessible and appropriate for use by psychotherapists. The primary audience to whom this book is addressed includes psychologists, psychiatrists, social workers, psychotherapists, counselors, and family doctors who are treating traumatized individuals. In addition, we provide guidelines to help practitioners understand how the body contributes to both the maintenance and resolution of trauma-related disorders, information that may be valuable to psychiatric nurses, occupational therapists, rehabilitation workers, crisis workers, victim advocates, disaster workers, body therapists, as well as graduate students and interns entering the fields of mental health and trauma treatment. Furthermore, with the understanding that knowledge is empowering, this book is designed to be accessible to and informative for traumatized clients who are seeking to understand the causes and cures for their suffering. Trauma in the Body, a sensorimotor approach to psychotherapy, is divided into two sections, theory and treatment. Part 1 explores the theoretical foundation and rationale for sensorimotor psychotherapy interventions, drawing on the century-old insights of Pierre Janet, as well as the work of contemporary experts in the areas of trauma treatment, neuroscience, attachment, affect regulation, dissociation, and the body. Chapter 1, Hierarchical Information Processing, Cognitive, Emotional, and Sensorimotor Dimensions, provides a rationale for a somatic treatment approach, describing how traumatic experience disrupts the body's physiological and emotional regulation, causing profound effects on information processing. The hierarchical information processing model is described and related to maladaptive patterns of top-down and bottom-up processing common to survivors of trauma. The requirements for effective treatment of traumatic experience, including attention to how mind and body process information and the role of bottom-up processing, are discussed. Chapter 2, Window of Tolerance, the Capacity for Modulating Arousal, describes the low tolerance for arousal and affect dysregulation as core symptoms of trauma-related disorders. Focusing on the central role of autonomic dysregulation in perpetuating the symptoms and complicating the treatment of trauma, this chapter examines the regulatory patterns of hypo- and hyperarousal related to the survival-oriented functions of the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems. These post-traumatic regulatory patterns challenge information processing by interfering with optimal arousal states and integrative capacity. Under conditions of arousal that are either too high or too low, traumatic experiences cannot be integrated. These regulatory parameters provide a foundational premise for the modulation model of sensorimotor psychotherapy. Chapter 3, Attachment, the Role of the Body in Dyadic Regulation, describes the regulatory role of attachment experience, its disruption by early traumatic experience, and its effect on the body. Literature from the field of attachment research, Alan Shore's work on affect regulation, and the distinction between interactive and autoregulation are utilized to describe the specific tendencies of self-regulation and autonomic dominance embodied in each of the four childhood attachment patterns. An example of how to address the dysregulatory effects of attachment failure in treatment at a bodily and autonomic level is described. Chapter 4, The Orienting Response, Narrowing the Field of Consciousness, explains the process of orienting, whereby we select sensory stimuli from the myriad possible cues from the environment and from internal experience. Various kinds of orienting are described, and the stages of the orienting response are delineated in a detailed case example. For the traumatized individual, the ability to orient to, interpret, and integrate sensory stimulation in an adaptive fashion is notably impaired and must be addressed as part of effective trauma treatment. Chapter 5, Defensive Subsystems, Mobilizing and Immobilizing Responses, describes various animal defensive subsystems, their origin and physical components that ultimately may contribute to post-traumatic symptoms. The stages of the defensive response are explained in relation to the case example introduced in the previous chapter. In treatment, traumatized persons are helped to 1. Reorganize survival-related defensive responses that exacerbate their symptoms, and 2. Achieve more adaptability and flexibility in their defensive patterns. Chapter 6, Adaptation, the Role of Action Systems and Tendencies, describes the psychobiological systems that have evolved to support adaptive responses to optimize survival. These systems provide the impetus to explore the world, play, participate in social relationships, regulate energy, form pair bonds, and care for others. Traumatized individuals typically experience difficulty in effectively utilizing these systems because chronic deployment of defensive subsystems takes precedence over other systems. The purpose of this chapter is to describe these action systems and their associated physical tendencies, examine how they relate, and consider how therapists can work with them so that clients can satisfactorily fulfill their objectives. This chapter also describes why there is a propensity to implement actions at a particular level of organization, ranging from reflective to adaptive. The impact of trauma and early life experiences on the action systems and on physical action tendencies is also addressed. Chapter 7, Psychological Trauma and the Brain, Toward a Neurobiological Treatment Model, authored by Ruth Lanius, Ulrich Lanius, Janina Fisher, and Pat Ogden, draws upon the neuroscience research to illuminate the effects of trauma on brain structures and functioning, as well as to explore the implications for treatment using body-based interventions. Neuroimaging technology has made possible the detailed study of how trauma impacts both cortical and subcortical processing of information. This research has profound implications for the treatment of trauma-based symptoms. An understanding of how treatment interventions may affect brain areas implicated in trauma can enhance both the specificity and the effectiveness of psychotherapy. This chapter also describes the differences observed in brain activity related to hyper versus hypoarousal responses to trauma. Part 2 of Trauma and the Body, A Sensorimotor Approach to Psychotherapy, describes the treatment philosophy and techniques of sensorimotor psychotherapy. Because clients with complex trauma can be triggered by interventions that access the body too quickly, attention is given to approaches and techniques that promote pacing, boundaries, and safe, gradual reconnection with the body. Clinical examples and explanations throughout the second section illustrate and clarify sensorimotor psychotherapy theory and practice. Chapter 8, Principles of Treatment, Putting Theory into Practice, translates the theoretical material described in previous chapters into practice, providing an orientation to the principles underlying sensorimotor psychotherapy, and applying hierarchical information processing theory to clinical intervention. Working in the present moment is emphasized, and transference and countertransference concepts are related specifically to the somatic experience of the client and treatment. Genet's pioneering work on phase-oriented treatment for traumatized individuals is integrated with contemporary theoretical perspectives to provide an umbrella under which to position sensorimotor psychotherapy interventions and treatment planning. Chapter 9, The Organization of Experience, Skills for Working with a Body in Present Time, describes specific techniques, drawn primarily from the Hikomi method, that allow client and therapist to safely observe, articulate, and explore present experience, with an emphasis on working with the organization of experience rather than insight. Mindfulness techniques that facilitate the regulation of arousal and allow exploration of the client's organization of present experience are described. How these skills are integrated and utilized in sensorimotor psychotherapy is explored, along with a section for clinicians on the pitfalls and benefits of the therapeutic use of touch. Chapter 10, Phase 1 Treatment, Developing Somatic Resources for Stabilization, describes the use of somatic resources to facilitate the management of trauma triggers, the modulation of arousal, self-soothing, tolerance of therapeutic attachment and collaboration, and improvement in daily functioning. The challenge for the therapist during this phase is that of bringing autonomic dysregulation under greater conscious control so that hyper and hypoarousal do not exacerbate the symptoms. The concept of the physical core/periphery is introduced as it relates to auto and interactive self-regulation. This chapter explains how the development of somatic resources contributes to gradual expansion of self-regulatory skills and paves the way for the processing of traumatic memories at the next phase of treatment. Chapter 11, Phase 2 Treatment, Processing Traumatic Memory and Restoring Acts of Triumph, describes how the client, having attained sufficient integrative capacity in the first phase of treatment, is now ready to develop a sense of mastery or triumph over the intense feelings, body sensations, and impulses associated with traumatic memories. This chapter explores the nature of traumatic memory and delineates how the client is enabled to process these memories somatically in order to experience a sense of success and triumph. How memory is safely re-evoked, how resources are retrieved, and how empowering actions are discovered and executed are discussed. Chapter 12, Phase 3 Treatment, Integration and Success in Normal Life, describes how the focus of treatment now shifts to establishing a life beyond trauma. Somatic interventions are used to help the client resolve relational issues, re-engage in society, and tolerate increased intimacy, risk-taking, and change. At this stage, the therapeutic relationship can be used as a laboratory or template for trying out new actions/options, which can be practiced until they become automatic tendencies. The dynamic relationship between the client's physical core and periphery is a template and metaphor for enabling somatic integration and the capacity for flexible adaptation to life in the present. The transformation of cognitive distortions that impede full engagement with life and increasing positive affect tolerance and capacity for pleasure are explored in this chapter. Traditionally trained therapists who are new to the idea of working with the body may hesitate to incorporate a sensorimotor approach. It may seem that utilizing the body states and movements that manifest during a psychotherapeutic session necessitate learning a whole new language and method of observation. These concerns are natural, and many psychotherapists find this new terrain to be intimidating. However, what we have found in teaching this method to clinicians since 1981 is that attuning to body cues is something that is already built into virtually every therapist's method of working with clients in their internal states. The majority of human communication is not through verbal language, but rather through body language, facial expression, eye contact, movement, behavior, posture, autonomic arousal, gestures, muscular tension, and so forth. In other words, the meaning and interpretation of each conversation that we have with another human being is built on observing, inferring, compiling, and making meaning of the other person's body movement, posture, and expression. And much of how we communicate in response is through our body reactions to the other. Indeed, at this juncture, the listener may actually be asking the opposite question. If this book is discussing a method that is based on a seemingly innate and highly sophisticated skill of interpreting body language and interactively regulating our co-conversant through this language, Why are we not already adept at the method described in this book? The art and science of the sensorimotor psychotherapist lies in making this unconscious process conscious. Thus, giving language to the nonverbal communication that is so integral to our interactions with others, including our clinical practice, that we have almost completely overlooked it as a primary object of study. In sensorimotor psychotherapy, understanding and translating the language of the body's communication is central. Thus, the process of learning sensorimotor psychotherapy includes the mindful study of how another's physical states and communications resonate in and affect our own body experience, and how they can be interpreted as a useful basis for consciously formulating both our verbal and nonverbal responses to our client. This book expresses the thoughtful study of this interactive process over the last 2.5 decades. Weaving sensorimotor psychotherapy theory and practice into psychodynamic or cognitive behavioral models of therapy, including EMDR and exposure treatments, helps to unify body and mind in the treatment of trauma. Moreover, this work can be effectively used as an adjunct to already existing psychotherapeutic modalities. It should be noted that the methods introduced in this book are not only applicable to trauma. A sensorimotor approach is equally applicable to the normal, non-traumatic range of childhood and family dynamics that shape the development and formation of the client's personality and interactive capacity. The ultimate aim of combining somatic and cognitive interventions is not only to alleviate symptoms and resolve the traumatic past, but also to help clients experience a new, reorganized sense of self. The sense of self develops not only in the context of beliefs, metaphors, and emotional responses, but evolves organically as the physical organization of the client's body changes. Some traumatized clients have a habitually collapsed, frozen, or immobilized body and an accompanying sense of self as ineffectual. Others experience chronic hyper-aroused, affect-dysregulated bodies and a sense of self that seems out of control. Sensorimotor psychotherapy helps these clients regulate their physical experiences and learn more adaptive actions so that their corresponding sense of self feels grounded, competent, and oriented toward present experience. As the arousal level, sensation, posture, and movement of the body adaptively change, a different, more positive sense of self emerges, supported by these physical changes. Thus, by synthesizing bottom-up and top-down interventions, we hope to combine the best of both worlds to help chronically traumatized clients find resolution and meaning in their lives, as well as develop a new, somatically integrated sense of self. Part 1. Theory. Chapter 1. Hierarchical Information Processing. Cognitive, Emotional, and Sensorimotor Dimensions. For traumatized individuals, the debilitating, repetitive cycle of interaction between mind and body keeps past trauma alive, disrupting the sense of self and maintaining trauma-related disorders. Many people are left with a fragmented memory of their traumatic experiences, a host of easily reactivated neurobiological responses, and baffling, intense, nonverbal memories. Sensorimotor reactions and symptoms that tell the story without words, as though the body knows what they do not know cognitively. They are often unaware that these reactions, intrusive body sensations, images, smells, physical pain and constriction, numbing, and the inability to modulate arousal, are in fact remnants of past trauma. Frequently uncertain of what happened and how they endured it, traumatized individuals tend to interpret these reactivated sensorimotor responses as data about their identity or selfhood. I am never safe. I am a marked woman. I am worthless and unlovable. These beliefs are reflected in the body and affect posture, breathing, freedom of movement, even heart rate and respiration. And each somatic adaptation to trauma, in turn, influences how traumatized people respond to the environment and make meaning of all subsequent experience. Rather than helping to resolve these symptoms, attempts to process traumatic events by describing them in words or venting the associated feelings can precipitate somatic remembering in the form of physical sensations, numbing, dysregulated arousal, and involuntary movements. These intense bodily responses, in turn, can fuel trauma-related emotions of terror, dread, helplessness, hopelessness, shame, and rage. Attempting to describe traumatic events thus brings the past suddenly into the present, and orientation to current reality may be partially or temporarily lost. Remembering the trauma is experienced as, "It's happening again. I'm still not safe." At those moments of feeling under threat, the thinking mind, the frontal cortex, is compromised. Accordingly, subsequent decisions and actions based on the bodily experience of threat tend to be impulsive, dangerous, or otherwise inappropriate to current reality. Yet again, trauma-related beliefs, that is, beliefs that exacerbate somatic symptoms, feel confirmed. It must be true that nothing good can happen to me. It must be true that I don't deserve to be safe. The complexity and variety of symptoms affecting both mind and body are perplexing to therapists and clients alike. Highlighting the role of dissociation in trauma symptoms, Pierre Genet emphasized that unresolved trauma results in profound deficits in the ability to integrate experiences. Processes that are normally unified, such as emotions, thoughts, identity, memory, and somatosensory elements, are separated. This integrative failure leads to an undue compartmentalization of experience. Elements of a trauma are not integrated into a unitary whole or an integrated sense of self. One form of compartmentalization is apparent in the propensity of traumatized individuals to alternate between 1. Emotional and bodily numbing and avoidance of cues reminiscent of the trauma, and 2. Intrusive reliving of the trauma via flashbacks, dreams, thoughts, and somatic symptoms. In the words of James Chu, this biphasic pattern is the result of dissociation. Traumatic events are distanced and dissociated from usual conscious awareness in the numbing phase, only to return in the intrusive phase. Markedly different symptoms occur in each dissociative phase. In the intrusive phase, the person is plagued by unintegrated fragments of traumatic memories that return unbidden. In the numbing phase, these fragments are kept at bay, but the individual feels numb and detached, living on the surface of consciousness. The dissociative symptoms in each phase are further complicated by being both psychological, or psychoform, and sensorimotor, or somatoform. Psychoform symptoms involve dissociation of mental functions and manifest at overwhelming affects, concentration difficulties, amnesia and other memory problems, and altered systems of belief. Somatoform dissociative symptoms involve body sensation, movement, and the senses, and include sensory distortions, dysregulated physiological arousal, lack of body sensation, pain, movement disorders, and re-experiencing the trauma in somatosensory fragments. Van der Hart and colleagues aptly noted that the psychoform and somatoform symptoms should be viewed as two sides of the same coin, because they are both expressions of underlying dissociative processes that transpire within the inseparable union of psyche and soma. The complicated mix of somatoform and psychoform symptoms begs for a treatment approach that directly addresses the effects of trauma on both the body and the mind. The triune brain. The capacity of human beings for self-awareness, interpretation, abstract thought, and feeling exists within a developmental and hierarchical relationship to the instinctual and non-conscious responses of the body. These hierarchically organized evolutionary responses range from instinctual arousal and physical defenses to feelings and emotional experience to thoughts, self-reflection, beliefs, and meaning-making. Wilbur's notion of hierarchical information processing described the evolutionary and functional hierarchy among three levels of organizing experience: cognitive, emotional, and sensory-motor levels. In neuropsychology, a parallel understanding of this hierarchy was articulated by McLean, who portrayed the concept of the triune brain as a brain with a brain within a brain. The reptilian brain, first to develop from an evolutionary perspective, governs arousal, homeostasis of the organism, and reproductive drives, and loosely relates to the sensory-motor level of information processing, including sensation and programmed movement impulses. Correlating with emotional processing, the paleo-mammalian brain, or limbic brain, found in all mammals, surrounds the reptilian brain and mediates emotion, memory, some social behavior, and learning. Last to develop psychogenetically is the neocortex, which enables cognitive information processing, such as self-awareness and conscious thought, and includes large portions of the corpus callosum, which bridges the right and left hemispheres of the brain and helps consolidate information. Thus, the three levels of information processing, cognitive, emotional, and sensorimotor, can be thought of as roughly correlating with the three levels of brain architecture. Different kinds of knowledge originate from each of these brains. The reptilian brain produces innate behavioral knowledge, basic instinctual action tendencies and habits related to primitive survival issues. The limbic system provides affective knowledge, subjective feelings, and emotional responses to world events. The neocortex generates declarative knowledge, propositional information about the world. Panksepp further clarified the behavioral and functional interference of these three brains. The inner, most reptilian core of the brain elaborates basic instinctual action plans for primitive emotional processes such as exploration, feeding, aggressive dominance displays, and sexuality. The old mammalian brain, or the limbic system, adds behavioral and psychological resolution to all of the emotions, and specifically mediates the social emotions such as separation distress / social bonding, playfulness, and maternal nurturance. The highly expanded neomammalian cortex generates higher cognitive functions, reasoning, and logical thought. Each of the three levels of the brain thus has its own understanding of the environment and responds accordingly. A particular level may become dominant and override the others, depending on the internal and environmental conditions. At the same time, these three levels are mutually dependent and intertwined, functioning as a cohesive whole, with the degree of integration of each level of processing affecting the efficacy of other levels. Fisher, Murray, and Bundy noted, "The brain functions as an integrated whole, but is comprised of systems that are hierarchically organized. The higher-level integrative functions evolved from and are dependent on the integrity of lower-level structures and on sensorimotor experience. Higher cortical centers of the brain are viewed as those that are responsible for abstraction, perception, reasoning, language, and learning. Sensory integration and intersensory association and contrast occur mainly within lower subcortical centers. Lower parts of the brain are conceptualized as developing and maturing before higher-level structures. Development and optimal functioning of higher-level structures are thought to be dependent, in part, on the development and optimal functioning of lower-level structures. In many ways, sensorimotor processing is foundational to other types of processing and includes the features of a simpler, more primitive form of information processing than do its more evolved counterparts. More directly associated with overall body processing, sensorimotor processing includes physical changes in response to sensory input, the fixed action patterns seen in defenses, changes in breathing and muscular tone, and autonomic nervous system activation. With its seat in the lower, older brain structures, sensorimotor processing relies on a relatively high number of fixed sequences of steps in the way it works. Some of these fixed sequences are well known, such as the startle reflex and the fight-flight response. The simplest sequences are involuntary reflexes, for example, the knee-jerk reaction, which are the most rigidly fixed and determined. More complex are the motor patterns that we learn at young ages, such as walking and running, which then become automatic. In the more highly evolved cognitive and emotional realms, we find fewer and fewer fixed sequences of steps and more complexity and variability of response. Panksepp likened this variance in complexity to the operating systems of a computer. Higher functions are typically more open, while lower ones are more reflexive, stereotyped, and closed. For instance, the basic vital functions of the brain, those that regulate organic bodily functions such as respiration, are organized at very low levels. Higher levels provide increasingly flexible control over these lower functions. To use a computer analogy, the lower functions resemble read-only memory, ROM, operating systems, which are essential for computers to do anything coherent, while the higher functions resemble random access memory, RAM space, where increasingly complex computations can be done. As more RAM space becomes available, the same operating systems can accomplish more and more. The relative abundance of RAM-like space in humans helps explain the complexity and sophistication of human abilities. Flexibility and abstraction of response increase at the higher cognitive level of processing. Greater fixity and concreteness of response increases at the sensorimotor level. Emotional processing falls in the middle, being neither as flexible as cognitive processing nor as fixed as sensorimotor processing. The three levels of the brain may not always work well together. In the aftermath of trauma, the integration of information processing on cognitive, emotional, and sensorimotor levels is often compromised. Dysregulated arousal may drive a traumatized person's emotional and cognitive processing, causing emotions to escalate, thoughts to spin, and misinterpretations of present environmental cues as those of a past trauma. For example, a client whose heart rate escalates at the sight of a tall, overweight, middle-aged man who is similar in physical appearance to her abusive uncle and who experiences a somatic sense of wanting to run is likely to interpret these sensorimotor reactions as meaning that she is not safe. She might then find herself having the thought, "This man is dangerous." This thought, in turn, is likely to increase her heart rate and the tension in her legs and feet, provoking more thoughts, such as, "I have to get out of here," and fueling trauma-related emotions of fear and dread. These emotions and sensorimotor reactions further sabotage her ability to appraise current reality accurately. Although recent authors have challenged the notion of a limbic system and emphasized that the neural networks responsible for social, emotional, attachment, and traumatic experiences are found throughout the brain, the concept of the triune brain, nevertheless, serves a valuable function of providing a connective metaphor among the artifacts of evolution, the contemporary nervous system, and some of the inherent difficulties related to the organization and disorganization of human consciousness. We draw on this metaphor to help illustrate how experience is organized on the three levels of information processing, and how the synergistic relationship among these levels is chronically impaired by unresolved trauma. Levels of information processing and the body. Cognitive and emotional processing strongly affect the body, and sensorimotor processing strongly affects cognitions and emotions. In clinical practice, we find it useful to both examine each level of information processing separately and consider the interweaving of cognitions, emotions, and sensorimotor responses. It is especially important for the therapist to observe how the body affects and is influenced by the processing of information on each of these levels of experience. Specific somatic techniques can then be selected and integrated with cognitive and emotional interventions so that adaptive information processing is increased on all three levels. Cognitive processing. The term cognitive processing refers to the capacity for conceptualizing, reasoning, meaning-making, problem-solving, and decision-making. It encompasses the ability to observe and abstract from experience, weigh a range of possibilities for action, plan for the accomplishment of goals, and evaluate the outcome of actions. Our actions as adults often reflect the hierarchical relationship of volitional cognitive processing over sensorimotor and emotional responses. We can decide cognitive function to ignore the sensation of hunger and not act on it, even while the physiological processes associated with hunger, such as the secretion of saliva and contraction of stomach muscles, continue. In cognitive theory, this dominance of cognitive functioning is called top-down processing, indicating that the upper level of processing, cognitive, can and often does override, steer, or interrupt the lower levels by elaborating upon or interfering with emotional and sensorimotor processing. Much adult activity is based upon top-down processing. Shore noted that, in adults, higher cortical areas act as a control center and that the orbital cortex dominates subcortical activity. We might think about what to accomplish for the day, outline plans, and then structure time to meet particular goals. While executing these plans, emotions and sensations, for example, frustration, fatigue, physical discomfort, may be overridden. It is as though we hover just above our somatic and emotional experience, knowing it's there, but not allowing it to be the primary determinant of our actions. For the traumatized individual, however, the intensity of trauma-related emotions and sensorimotor reactions hinders the ability of top-down processing to dominate subcortical activity. Additional difficulty with cognitive processing occurs because traumatized people typically form inflexible maladaptive interpretations of the trauma or other life experience. Such interpretations take the form of inadvertent generalized thoughts that are negatively biased and erroneous, such as, "I am bad," "it was my fault," "all men are dangerous," and so on. Each thought is an action, that is, a mental action, that generates not only more negative cognitions, but also corresponding emotions and sensorimotor reactions. These thoughts play a part in the way traumatized people continue to organize their experience, which is shaped by pervasive patterns of cognitive distortions. These distortions result in persistent experiences of low self-esteem and defeat, as well as a chronic perception of a lack of safety. Cognitive processing is inextricably linked with our bodies. Bodily feelings or somatic markers influence cognitive decision-making, logic, speed, and context of thought. The background body sensations that arise during cognitive processing form a biasing substratum that influences the functioning of the individual in all decision-making processes and self-experiences. The very structure of reason itself comes from the details of our embodiment. The same neural and cognitive mechanisms that allow us to perceive and move around also create our conceptual systems and modes of reason. The circuits of the brain that are used for mental action are the same ones that are used for physical action. The movement of the body as a child matures is essential for the optimal development of memory, language, and learning. Ratty speculated that motor neurons may even drive our sense of self-awareness. Thus, how we think and what we think are literally shaped by the body, and vice versa. According to Lakoff and Johnson, the embodiment of reason via the sensorimotor system is a crucial part of the explanation of why it is possible for our concepts to fit so well with the way we function in the world. They fit so well because they have evolved from our sensorimotor systems, which have in turn evolved to allow us to function well in our physical environment. Our concepts cannot be a direct reflection of external, objective, mind-free reality because our sensorimotor system plays a crucial role in shaping them. All early relational dynamics with primary caregivers, traumatic or non-traumatic, serve as blueprints for the child's developing cognition and belief systems. And these belief systems influence the posture, structure, and movement of the body, and vice versa. If a child grows up in a family that values high achievement and encourages the child to try harder at everything she undertakes, her posture, gesture, and movement will be shaped by this influence. If this value is held at the expense of other values, such as, you are loved for yourself, not for what you do, the child's musculature will probably be toned and tense. Her body will be mobilized to try harder. In contrast, a child who grows up in an environment where trying hard is either discouraged or seen as maladaptive, and where everything he achieves is undervalued, might have a sunken chest, limp arms, and shallow breath. His body will reflect a childhood experience of not feeling assertive and confident, of giving up. It may be difficult for this child to mobilize consistent energy or sufficient self-confidence to complete a difficult task. Chronic postural and movement tendencies serve to sustain certain beliefs and cognitive distortions, and the physical patterns in turn contribute to these same beliefs. If the body shapes reason and beliefs, and vice versa, then the capacity for insight and self-reflection, our ability to know our own minds, will be correspondingly limited by the body's influence. How, then, can we begin to know our own minds? If the patterns of the body's movements and posture influence reason, cognitive self-reflection might not be the only or even the best way of bringing the workings of the mind to consciousness. Reflecting on, exploring, and changing the posture and movement of the body may be as valuable. For example, Terry came to therapy with a body filled with fear. His shoulders were hiked up, his head was retracted, his chest was tight with held breath. His eyes darted around, and he had an exaggerated startle reflex. his chronic experience of his body did not support the reasonable belief that his past trauma was over and he was not currently in danger. Terry reported that he knew he was safe, but he felt as if he were unsafe. In therapy, the sensations and movements of his body were addressed in order to reveal their impact on his beliefs, as well as to change both his body and beliefs. In the course of therapy, Terry became aware of his mind-body interface. He worked both cognitively and physically to change his embodied belief by relaxing his shoulders, deepening his breathing, and feeling his legs as firmly grounded and supporting his upper body. During this exploration, memories of his trauma emerged and were dealt with and resolved. After several sessions, Terry described a shift in his body and his beliefs. "Now my body feels like it supports me. I feel safer when my shoulders are more relaxed and my breathing is not so shallow and tense." Emotional processing. Emotions add motivational coloring to cognitive processing and act as signals that direct us to notice and attend to particular cues. Emotions help us take adaptive action by calling attention to significant environmental events and stimuli. The emotional brain directs us toward experiences we seek, and the cognitive brain tries to help us get there as intelligently as possible. According to Yenis, as with muscle tone that serves as the basic platform for the execution of our movements, emotions represent the premotor platform as either drives or deterrents for most of our actions. Traumatized people characteristically lose the capacity to draw upon emotions as guides for action. They might suffer from alexithymia, a disturbance in the ability to recognize and find words for emotions. They may be detached from their emotions, presenting with flat affect and complaining of a lack of interest and motivation in life, and an inability to take action. Or, their emotions may be experienced as urgent and immediate calls to action. The capacity to reflect on an emotion and allow it to be part of the data that guides action is lost, and its expression becomes explosive and uncontrolled. Through nonverbal remembering triggered by reminders of the event, traumatized individuals relive the emotional tenor of previous traumatic experiences, finding themselves at the mercy of intense trauma-related emotions. These emotions can lead to impulsive, ineffective, conflicting, and irrational actions, such as lashing out physically or verbally, or feeling helpless, frozen, and numb. Emotional arousal in an individual with unresolved trauma thus often provokes action that is not an adaptive response to the present non-traumatic environment, but is more likely a version of an adaptive response to the original trauma. The term emotional processing refers to the capacity to experience, describe, express, and integrate affective states. Emotions usually follow a phasic pattern with a beginning, middle, and an end. However, for many traumatized individuals, the end never arrives. Emotional responses to very strong stimuli, such as trauma, do not appear to extinguish, a phenomenon that has been demonstrated in animal research by Ledoux, who noted that emotional memory may be forever. Traumatized individuals are often fixated on trauma-related emotions of grief, fear, terror, or anger. There might be a variety of reasons for this fixation: denial or lack of awareness of the connection between current emotions and past trauma, attempts to avoid more painful emotions, the inability to think clearly, or the inability to distinguish emotions from bodily sensations. Moreover, the emotions may relate to a variety of past events rather than only one. All these elements contribute to a circular, apparently never-ending re-experiencing of trauma-related emotions. Like Damasio, Frieda emphasized that emotions are inseparable from the body. Emotions are matters of the body, of the heart, the stomach, and intestines, of bodily activity and impulse. They are of the flesh and sear the flesh. Also, they are of the brain and the veins. Whether we are aware of these internal sensations or not, they both contribute to and are the result of emotions. Butterflies in the stomach tell us that we are excited. A heavy feeling in the chest speaks of grief. Tension in the jaw informs us as we are angry. An all-over tingling feeling indicates fear. Damasio stated that emotions have two features. First, the internal sensation, which is inwardly directed and private, and second, visible feature, which is outwardly directed and public. Internal emotional states are thus experienced as subjective bodily sensations and are reflected in our outward presentation, giving signals to others around us about how we feel. Anger might be visible in the purse of the mouth, clenched fists, narrowed eyes, and general bodily tension. Fear may be communicated in hunched shoulders, held breath, and a pleading look in the eyes, or in a bracing or moving away from the frightening stimulus. These bodily stances might be an immediate response to a current situation or a chronic, pervasive emotional state. In therapy, we can utilize the outwardly directed physical manifestations to clarify, work with, and resolve trauma-related emotions. One client who presented with visible tension across her shoulders was directed to notice this tension and explore it for meaning. She reported that it felt like the tension was holding back anger, an insight gleaned from awareness of her body rather than from cognition. This insight led to the realization of an erroneous belief that she had no right to be angry at her abusive father. Working with the anger through the tension itself, slowly executing the movement the tension wanted to make, processing the associated memories, beliefs, and emotions, and learning to relax the tension, assisted this client on her road to fuller self-expression and resolution of the emotions related to her past traumatic events. In the previous example, working with a client's emotion simultaneously with its cognitive component was effective. However, despite the inextricable involvement of emotions with the body and cognitions, when trauma-related emotions such as terror are coupled with body sensation such as trembling, the client is encouraged to distinguish body sensations and movements from emotions. In these instances, we help clients differentiate emotional processing from sensorimotor processing. In our vernacular, emotional processing pertains to experiencing, articulating, and integrating emotions, whereas sensorimotor processing refers to experiencing, articulating, and integrating physical/sensory perception, body sensation, physiological arousal, and motor functioning. This differentiation between these two levels of processing is important in trauma therapy because clients often fail to discriminate between body sensations of arousal or movement and emotional feeling, which can lead to the escalation of both. This lack of discrimination is partly due to the fact that sensation and emotion occur simultaneously and suddenly, and partly because affect dysregulation and degrees of functional alexithymia are characteristic of post-traumatic symptoms. Clients often find themselves struggling with the effects of overwhelming emotions, with little awareness of how the body participates in creating and sustaining these emotions. Conflating trauma-related emotions and the body sensations of physiological arousal can thus complicate the client's capacity to process and resolve the emotions related to traumatic events. If body sensations, for example, trembling, rapid heart rate, are interpreted as an emotion, for example, panic, each level of experience, sensory motor and emotional, inflates and compounds the other. Both the rapid heart rate and the panic are exacerbated when experienced simultaneously. If cognition in the form of a belief is then added, such as, I am not safe, physical sensation and emotion will further intensify. In such a situation, arousal can escalate beyond the person's tolerance, and integrative capacity will be compromised. By working with a client to differentiate the sensation of physiological arousal from emotional arousal, the amount and kind of information are reduced and more ably processed by the client. Physiological arousal can be addressed and often diminished by uncoupling trauma-related emotion from body sensation through attending exclusively to the physical sensations of the arousal, without attributing meaning or emotion to them. Then, after the physiological arousal returns to a tolerable level, the client can look at the emotional contents of the traumatic experience and integrate both. For example, a Vietnam veteran, Martin, came to therapy to get rid of his nightmares and feelings of being chronically emotionally.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.